accept this. I guess I wanted to start this with the point that at first I wasn't sure why I'd want to do this. To speak in front of a terrifying crowd of phobious people who suffered so long ago as this piece of writing. Displaying the transparency I sometimes have trouble with showing good friends. I'm always drawn to the psychology behind why we do the things we do, as well as that I've always been drawn to the art talks I've heard here within the past. How brave people before me have come up to speak rivers that flow with charged honesty, how they can wrong me in the times of words or come crashing down on faulty ideas or prior reasoning, given this new perspective. I loved how they bound unity between the silent and unmoving moments, weaving connections through shared understanding, experiences, or growth. Growth of learning the ins and outs of the speaker's thoughts and beliefs behind them, to digest them like food, breaking down palatable ideas into smaller raw elements, to then reconstruct into your own understanding. And with this, I thought I would try it. I love art and writing, though the expression of these things can be vulnerable. I know that for me to truly care about something, fear has to linger within, and I know that I can't selectively know. The first piece I've done worth remembering was a simple project of small balls of bakeable clay I made in grade 10. One of which I would carry around with me for 24 hours within my bag or pocket, collecting the markings of the objects around me. I would then bake the clay as a sort of time capsule, preserving the events of the day as a metaphor for the daily impressions my environment makes on me, shaping my malleable self. I started to see this through the effect that aspects of my environment had on me, allowing me to see the extensions of myself within the world around me. This was inspired by how I started to notice the way different rooms I had spent long periods of time in started to become homes, their scratches and marks becoming familiar like the wrinkles and scars on my skin. How I found sentimental value in the objectively worthless things I would find in a box, or that I could live vicariously through the success or happiness of a friend. It was the first time I started to see the world as a unified, started to see the world unified as a large interconnected thing, with me being a piece of a larger and ever-changing puzzle, moving with others as a unit, in the same way the cells of my body swam through the streets and rivers of my veins. I remember this project gave me kind reminders of the effect I had on those around me as well, as I find smears of clay on binders or on the inside of pockets. Around the same time, I started to write down the events of the day as well, which I still kept the habit of. After this, my art production slowed, but I continued to write and create ideas for it, though I was always too nervous or uncommitted to follow through with them. I had always been quite wary of showing people the thoughts and ideas I thought were too personal, and though I had realized at the time it was something I needed to change, there's always been a large difference for me in knowing how I should do things and actually implementing these beliefs. And so I kept on as a quiet observer, with my growth within the confines of my notebook and a couple good friends. Though I was really content with this at first, I started to live through my notebook in romantic documentation, discovering the control I had in writing my life as the narrative I wanted it to be. And not in a fabricated way, but that I could use the bias of my subjectivity to paint beauty into the simple information and objects I would come across. Seeing the indents and scratches on worn furniture in my house, as stretch maps of bloated history, the personality and the art of my peers as little windows into minds more complex and individual than I'll ever know, or the luck that I would invest into rooms with trinkets I found. I started to use my notebook to express the admiration I found in my environment, and evoke its love within my own mind. I stopped sleeping as much so I could go on nightly walks, waiting and reading in my room, until it was late enough that I could have the dimly lit streets to myself, reflecting on the events of the day along with the moon above me, reflecting the light of the sun. This continued a while after this. Still writing and making quiet art, the first of which were small drawings and paintings of a specific pattern that represented the constants of change I started to notice within the world around me. Inspired by a lot of change I was experiencing within my environment and in turn how I felt it, as well as the fear to vote. I wanted to express this in the drawings by looking slightly like water or wind, mountains or the wrinkles on worn skin to portray the shifts and movement I saw internally and externally, working with themes of fluidity, growth, change, and impermanence. It was through the points of view or traits of myself changed or lost through time that made me grow wary of what was truly going to stay as a part of me for me, making me more afraid than I probably should have been of the parts of me I'll lose along the way, forgetting about the parts of me I'll grow as well. My idea of stability changed from something concrete that was necessary to lean on throughout my life to instead being something that was as fluid as I was, something that gained strength and weakness with me. I wanted to show how this constance of change washed through any sort of rigid cage I made to try and capture permanent happiness and fulfillment. Not to say that I couldn't experience these things momentarily, but that they changed along with the rest of me, constantly slipping from my grasp when the time was right. This was an odd realization for me because it disproved any sense of destination within my life. Whether that be a life goal, getting over a certain fear, figuring out how I best live my life, or a dream job, my life would never be finalized as a whole by these instances in time. It was accepting that no matter how large a feast, my fullness would always wash away to hunger eventually, accepting that I was going to wander through life always hungry, searching to be fed. Although I knew that this wasn't the curse I had made it out to be when I was first afraid of the things I would lose and what I would forget. But change isn't something forced upon me, but rather what I embody as something alive and moving. Around the same time, I started to become reinterested in clay because I thought the idea of shaping the self from the project I had done in grade 10 expanded well on the ideas I was thinking of at the time. Eventually, I started using the pottery wheel, which to me symbolized the balance and neutrality I was trying to achieve within my daily life, as the necessary balance on all sides of the clay on the wheel was what allowed for the stability at the center to create my art, symbolically changing within myself rather than the environmental shaping I had used in the prior project. To show the change, I was trying to consciously implement. Balancing acceptance of the moment versus dissatisfied motivation to change, or obeying my needs and desires versus those of others, or knowing to balance the things I need versus what I want, as well as the rest of my tries at balance and stability between things like this. At first, I tried to show the process of shaping the pots as much as I could, making divots and curves to display the balance and their symmetry, making my pottery little emblems of me trying to even out my life. After a while, the pottery I was making started to drift more into a practical use than before, when I realized I didn't have to buy plates, bowls, or cups when I moved out, because I could make them myself. So with my art drifting to functionality, I gravitated more towards writing to express my ideas. I often write by recounting ideas of the day within poems or blurbs, trying to expand them. The latest project I've been working on is a story of a family trying to fill the gap within their lives of a fire that claimed their home and all of their things, to work with themes of deconstruction and chaos versus the construction and order that living things create to build and grow ourselves. With each of the characters unknowingly trying to recreate their home and the understanding of their lives and the understanding of their lives in the sterile, temporary home they live in. Though I've sort of started to avoid writing because of the pressure I've built around it, needing to meet a certain standard now that it's something I acknowledge that I love and care for. And I've used this to create fear and aversion rather than delving deeper into it and accepting the fear in it as proof of its importance to me. I know that I shouldn't be confined to fear, and I try not to most of the time. and I also know that I'm carried by different desires and deterrents, pushing and pulling me to and from the things I'm attracted and repelled from. And which of these desires I end up following forms the narrative of my life, as well as my habituality of these fallen desires creates who I am as well. And I don't want to create or live within stories of running from fear, unknowingly carrying the weight of it as I run myself in circles like a dog chasing the tail end of it down. But I know I can't do this forever, and showing my affection or ideas to others is more connected than I would think, because fear is so inherently human. It's intertwined with love because I'm not afraid of the things I don't care about. And with that, I guess I want to say that I love you all, and not because I should, or that it's the right thing to do to be compassionate, but because I'm selfish and I love the parts of my malleable self shaped by the beauty of the people around me. Directly and indirectly through interwoven friends and friends of friends, circulating thoughts of each other or the world or simple things like the way we say certain words or act around each other. And I feel like I've been repeating this a lot in different ways throughout this art talk, but the world would be such a boring place if the self really did end where your skin and hair. And that it's denying pieces of myself to hide fearfully within notebooks and contained actions. So I guess in conclusion, I did this talk to accept and partake in the movement around me instead of remaining a fearful observer, and to make use of the moment rather than try to disregard it, afraid or distracted. Because I know that for me to love something, fear naturally has to linger within it. And I also know that I can't selectively know it.